Yes, thanks for coming to our presentation. Today, we will present you a totally new kind of how to monetize free apps. But before I start, I would like to introduce my colleague and myself. We are from Bitforce IT Hamburg. My colleague, Mr. René Mertins, he is our head of development. My name is Boris von Lüttwitz, and I'm the managing director. We support our partners and customers as software developer, as well as provider of software solutions. And today, I would like to introduce our new project, Aponzor. First, a few features on the current Android app market. 2 out of 3 apps are offered as free apps. But when we have a look at the recent download features, we will find out that the 2/3 of free apps represents more than 99% of the downloads. Of course, not all the apps are focused on monetization. Corporate apps, for example, are often used as free additional service, but for the most apps, the monetization is a really important topic. And the currently most often used monetization models for free apps are in-app purchase and in-app advertising. The use of in-app purchase grows fast for some apps, especially for the game sector, benefits from this in-app purchase. Of course, for the in-app purchase, you need additional values or content for your app to make the user buy it. In-app advertising is the most used monetizing model for free apps. To make a significant profit with this model, you need a high number of impressions. Important for a successful usage of in-app advertising is a high number of users and a frequent use over a long period. Unfortunately, in-app advertising causes also some disadvantages. Especially the small screens of smartphones. Ads are annoying the user and often they have a negative impact on the usability. Some display ads interfere with the design of your app. And a growing problem are ad blockers, because meanwhile the ad blockers, which do not require a rooted smartphone, which make it much more easy to use them. The volatile click prices make it also really extremely hard for you to calculate the future revenue. And a particular negative effect, especially for the advertiser, is the low user acceptance of in-app advertising. So to underline this statement, I will show you the ad reaction, a chart of the ad reaction study 2012 by Milward and Brown. It points out that mobile ads are one of the most unpopular types of advertising. And this is really a big problem for the advertisers, because the internet usage is shifting more and more to the mobile devices. The advertisers have to react on this trend and they have to adapt the online strategies. In-app advertising is a big challenge for the advertiser. The small display ads are not able to transfer the advertising message to the user, and they often disturb him. Interstitial provides much more possibilities, but they are really limited in use. Ultimately, the advertising meets the user at a bad time, because many apps are tools for him. And at the moment, when he uses these tools or these apps, he expects to solve a problem or to solve a task, and he's not open for any advertising message. These are really unattractive conditions for the advertisers. On the other hand, what do you as ad developer want? First of all, you expect an adequate revenue. That's the reason why you're here. But all measures to increase the revenue should not disturb the usage of your app. And of course, also not the number of your app users. Your app should continue well or even better in competition with other apps. And last but not least, a good monetization model should be adaptable for nearly all of your apps, and the implementation should be simple. We think about how we can give advertisers a way to participate in the increasing use of mobile devices with the marketing activities. These activities should disturb the user as little as possible while he's using the app and reach him in a moment when he's open-minded to receive the advertising message. Only if the advertiser is successful, he is able to pay an attractive commission. And when the usage of your app is not disturbed by ads, it will have a sustainable positive impact on the usage and on the number of the user. So, sorry about that. Aponzo transforms your app or your app users to recipients of the newsletters. This transformation of the in-app advertising to the newsletter, to the email newsletter, gives sponsors a much better way to receive customer awareness. And therefore, sponsors pay a good commission. In email marketing, they have already a lot of experience. Our idea is quite easy. The app developer implements the Aponzo SDK into his free app. When the user of your app installs the app at the first time, he is asked to subscribe the newsletter of the sponsor, which has to be confirmed by clicking. The advertiser will pay a commission for each subscriber of approximately 20 up to 40 euro cent, and this is regardless of those who uninstall the app later. And how you can see on the chart, in our Steals Modus test, in March 2003, we had an average revenue for 1,000 installations of more than 168 euro. And you can calculate, it's really easy, about 60 and 70% of the user which installed the app make also the subscription. And the average commission was about 26 euro cent. And our rule is to find an adequate sponsor for your app. So, and now the more interesting part, the technical part, this was only marketing.
Thank you. I think I will take this microphone because this is too high for me to speak on. And it's easier. So first of all, I will start to introduce you the whole process in technical details. All starts with our five different kinds of actors. Oh, what's going on here? Why it's so fast? Sorry. Normally it starts with the five actors. The five actors are the sponsors, which are creating campaigns. And we have the app developer, which is producing apps. And we have users who hopefully download these apps. And there are the technical actors, the Aponzo web services, and any kind of app store. And an Aponzo sponsored app is possible, you can publish this to any app store. So there's no dependencies to any stuff, and Google virus scanners and so on doesn't recognize the Aponzo. So publish where you want, it's no problem. So everything starts with the sponsor is creating a campaign. The campaign is including categories. These categories are also one-to-one the same like in the Play Store, but we have additional ones like male and female, because when you have an app like a shopping app styling guide or something like this, it's normally a woman that is using this app, and it's making a better commission for sponsors. So a model magazine can be the sponsor. So if you don't know, it's more male or female. So we have sponsors like so selling everything, cheap stuff and so on. So they only spend about 20 euro cent for a commission, and the model magazine would spend 40 euro cent because they know they only get women. And they have to set up the unit price. The unit price is that price that you get as a developer for any commission, for any conversion of an installation to a newsletter registration. we get our money from the sponsor. So when we make an okay, it's not part of the process. I will follow on to the process. This is something of sales stuff. The amount of registrations the sponsor wants, and the countries where the device has to be located on registration time. This is very important for legal stuff and law and so on. A German company wants German newsletter registrations, and it's not interested in US or Chinese people. The next thing is, when we now have some sponsors, is an app developer. Something is wrong with the presentation. creating an application profile in our system. To do this, he has also to categorize his app, and he is to upload the APK without the SDK of AppSponsor. So our editors can make a review of your app, only good apps and quality apps are accepted by us. So when the editors are finish the revenue, you get an app key. This is in 3 to 15 characters long string. This is human readable. It should be something like the name of your app when it's not so long. And RSR public key, which is base64 encrypted. This is need to encrypt all the personal data later on the device. So next thing. Now the developer can implement our SDK and can publish his app. He's always doing two steps here. Okay, he's publishing his app to any kind of app store. Now hopefully a user comes and finds your apps and installs it. Everything is went normally, like it's normally the process of the app store. So the user got the app, and now on the first start, the system will recognize this. She will not find any known offline state for this on this device. So he's asking the AppSponsor web service for getting a registration state. New user, no state found. So he's responding with a list of possible sponsors. We always transfer when there's more than one sponsor. We transfer all of them, but we are ordering them. First one is best choice, and the algorithm behind this is frequently updated. So normally, the first one is the one with the highest unit price, but it also could be the one that when it gets most fast registration, it will pay out fast as others. So then there's a sponsor that's only needing, has left 10 registrations and then would pay to all the developers a commission. And it's better to put them in first place instead of the one with the highest unit price. But it's changing frequently, and it is not. And the developer has a possibility to, in our SDK, to select the sponsor by himself when he wants. Now I will make a small demonstration. Depending on that, we have very poor internet connection here. we decided to only show one application. This application is specially prepared to use a small application service running on my notebook. So normally want to show two different apps that are already in the App Store, but now it's not possible. So this app, Hundehoroscope, or in English Dogs Horoscope, is accessible in the Google Play Store, but only in Germany, Austria, and Switzerland, because we want to make the testing area as small as possible. So that's dark. That was super. smart. So here is the app. It's now starting. So nothing happens. It took its time, because normally the state check should not disturb the user. And now it's a demo devil. I think something is totally disconnected here. come, let's take the other one.
You can make it with the live.
Yeah. This one is now using the internet. Hopefully we have internet connection. So it was very fast. This is how it should work. The system now has recognized that this app is not sponsored, it's not registered in the moment, and he has the app is for Doc's Horoscopes. So the user should have a dog, and the sponsor is Dog's Finest. It's an online shop for dog stuff like belts and so on. So now the system is asking you to make an opt-in. So this is now in German. He's asking. He's saying, "Oh, thank you for using this app. We are Dog's Finest and sponsoring this. You, Boris, do you want to register to the newsletter of Dog's Finest? It's no problem. You can dissubscribe this every time you want. If you want some more information, go on here. And the registration period is unlimited. So this means when I now select OK to accept this, it's an opt-in, then the app will work for me forever. So you as developer can also decide to make 1 year subscriptions, so you can get from any user you get over 1 year using your app, a second lead provision, and on a second year, a third, and a fourth, and so on and so on. And depending on the possible sponsors, you're getting more and more and higher commissions with the same app without any. Okay. You see, it's very simple. After that, when you restart now the app, you will does not see any disruption of the user anymore. So, to a lot of people before us are talking about that all this advertising stuff, especially when you are using personal data, needs to be as transparent and and needs to be secure. So we have decided to make our own policy. And these policies are, we have transparency, and we show the process in any detail. In the moment, the web pages are still in the building process, but in the next days, we will publish all web pages where you can see the whole process in any detail. You can ask us about anything. If you want, you can get the source code. It's no problem. The SDK is optimized and obfuscated, but only for performance issues, not to hide all this secret, because there is no secret in this SDK. We encrypt data and send them over SDSL connections. So the next thing is we should be secure. We use as strong security as possible, encryption technologies as possible. This is on Android devices is RSA encryption by using the Bouncy Castle provider. We use 1024-bit long RSA key pairs, and every app gets its own public key, and the private key is kept inside our in-house infrastructure. So in the internet, it is not possible to collect or grab any information that is encryptable. The next thing is we try to transfer as less data as possible, because not everyone has a flat rate, and it's and internet connection is also not always possible. So our SDK is trying to get a registration and is saving the state. And the state now lives for minimum 2 weeks on your device before we try a new online update. And it's not possible, we enhance this period. So normally the user is not disrupted also when he has no internet connection or some what else happens. We always encrypt everything. We never transfer any decrypted data to the internet. The only stuff we encrypted is something like the version number of the used SDK library and so on. But personal data like your email address or your display name are for controlling mechanisms always hashed, and for transport information, transporting them to the sponsor, they are always asymmetrical encrypted by RSA. Yes, the next thing I already said, we always use hashes for transfer and for business logic. This means all our database is anonymous. We also doesn't have any information about personal about the person himself. We don't know any email address, we don't know display names, we only know hashes. We can compare hashes, we can see different users, and we can see own devices. The system doesn't allow us to see if a device changes the user. It's also impossible for us. And this is wanted. Only the existence of a device in the hands of one user we can see, and we can split between how many devices a user has from other database, but we don't know who he is. It's only a hash for us. So next thing is, we never keep decrypted data in the internet. Try it, hack our servers. Some of our stuff is also in the Amazon cloud in Ireland and some on dedicated systems. Try it, you will collect only some encrypted Bayesian 64 strings from a database which are encrypted by app and by attributes. So it should be fun to decrypt only one email address. So let's think, we encrypt by app and attribute. We try to keep all the data anonymous till the delivery to the sponsor. Only the sponsor that had made the subscription and has shown you the privacy policy and so on is allowed to get your personal data. We also not we have an automatically process which is transferring the data from the encryption of the app to the encryption of the sponsor. And the sponsors get an assigned and closed desktop application from us, which where he is only for him is only possible to decrypt his own lots of subscriptions he got from us. No one else and nothing else. So, and the next thing is, we try to provide a full feature set tooling for everyone. We have a sponsoring portal, not in the moment, but it's coming up in the next time, so we can get sponsoring from also small companies. And we have a developer portal. This is now in beta stadium today. It reached that stadium, just got a new version. And we have the SDK for the developers to include with full documentation. And a demo application, which is showing all the complete implementation of the SDK. And yeah, that's all. Of tooling we have. So the SDK is split in two parts. You got the first part. What's going on here? I always get two clicks. The first part is the client library project. It's a normal ADT Eclipse project. But have you ever used another SDK? Normally you get the source code when you use something like Holo Everywhere and so on. We want to make an optimized SDK, so we already give you an obfuscated and optimized jar file, which is only excluded the R class, because this R class needs to be merged with your R class of your application. This makes sure that also when you not optimize and obfuscate your application by publishing to an app store, our part of the application is running as fast as possible. Because we are optimized and obfuscated. We have a small, and our SDK is coming from 180 kilobytes to 70 kilobytes by optimizing. And this 70 kilobytes is, I think, is 90% the logo of the company in three different resolutions. And the second part of the SDK is a simple demo application. This is a small Android application which is showing any method you can use from the SDK as one button on your screen. So you as developer can try with this application your app key, your public key, and you can walk through all the steps of the process if you want. So now we go over to some coding stuff. The first and simplest way to implement the Aponzo SDK in your application is first, initialize and configure the SDK manager. The minimum configuration is to set up your app key. I need some mouse. See, is your app key in this example here, the Aponzo demo application, and your Base64 encoded public key. All the other stuff here for configuration you can provide when you want that. We can show useful information in error situations and so on. The next thing is you need some one-time call, the init. The init needs an activity, because this activity needs to be the launching activity, because the entry activity, because this is the activity where we go back when we are out of the registration process. So this should be your application, the screen that should be shown when after registration process has finished. Also, we need this activity to sync us with a UI thread. And that is another point. Our SDK is running completely in separated threads. And it's not throwing any exceptions. They are all cached internally. And we have a unified callback mechanism where you can register. I will show you the next example, where you get all the responses, also exceptions. So you as developer of your app can decide what you're doing with it. We don't want to be that your app is crashing about errors we made. So, and the last thing, and this is very simple, this is the kind that we use in the Docs Horoscope application, is we call verify with a parameter for closed application true. This means Aponzo is doing everything for you automatically. And if Aponzo, for example, in the moment, we are only supporting Germany, Austria, and Switzerland, and when this app with verify true is started outside one of these three countries, it will show an error message about, hey, you are not in Germany. Here are some useful information from the app developer. Get an alternative app or something like this, and then it will close your app. And it's not closing like calling finish on activity. It's closing by deleting the PID from the PID list of the Unix system. So it's really done then. So this is a simple way, and this is very, it's only possible when you start to complete a new app and only want to publish this to sponsored regions. The next one is the second simplest one, and I think the most useful one for every developer. In this scenario, you do like an example one, you configure your Aponzo manager, but then you register yourself as a Aponzo listener. So a Aponzo listener is getting all kinds of response from the manager on any step we are doing. In verify mode, you only get end results on the Aponzo listener. This means complete responses from finished state or registration processes or catched exceptions on any error state. So you as developer can then decide what you're doing after an error or after a successful registration or an unsuccessful registration. So to handle this, the next thing is to also call verify with application set to close. So now you have to handle the close of your application or to show in-app advertising or what you want or make a light version. My mouse is back. There's a normal event listener. The Aponzo listener interface is only introducing you one method, it's the onResponse method, and the response event is thrown to him. And a response can have the type response or exception. Response is always coming from a successful end of a RESTful web call. And an exception is something that happens that we don't want, so like unallowed countries and so on. What we will see in the next example here. Oh, it's too long? Oh. Okay, then fast. The most important responses you get are state responses that are saying you the user is registered or not, and if you got paid for him or not. And the second one is the result of a complete registration process, which is telling you is the registration successful or not successful. And normally it's not paid, but it's also a transfer there. And the most important when you're making custom implementations to produce an app that is published worldwide is to capture all the exceptions that are from there. The most important ones is the app is all opened in a country that is not allowed, so use in-advertising or something else, or the device has no email account, so a news registration is impossible. We have no network connection, so we can't call to our web services. So to say something like, please do later, try again later. We don't have a sponsor, it should never happen, but it could be. And the registration was not approved. It means the user has gone through the process but not hit the accept button. And you got no opt-in. In all these cases, do something else. To make this easy, so now the last thing is we've introduced three simple helper methods. So the first one is you can disable the manager for all time, or till a specific date you say yes. So you can say, no, country not allowed, disable for 6 months. In 6 months, the verify mode will automatically reactivate and try it again. Possible, the country is then accessible for sponsor. And enable manually, and close the app, like I explained already, killing the pit from the Unix pit list. That's now the more manual process. Okay, and the last thing is, at the moment, Germany, Austria, Switzerland. Next, we are working on the moment is UK, USA. We have already included different profiles with more attributes, but not used. We need the user experience in the moment before we are starting this profiles, but they are already in the SDK, so you don't need an SDK update when we start to use these profiles. And end user education campaign to make it most acceptable for the user. So they should see the Aponza logo and know, okay, they are from Germany, they make it secure, and it's I get a good app, a good premium app for free then. So thank you for listening, and sorry that I took too long, I still have some charts. And if you need some more information, visit us on the internet. Thank you.